Okay, it must be already clear that our software for Blender animation change is used by mainly two kind of people. One is the animator, and that thing has already been shown, in which the animator selects all the objects which can be changed and the ranges in which each object can be changed and all that logic and everything. That part is done by the animator, the one who can operate the Blender thing. Now we come to the lay user, the people whom we are targeting, the people who don't know Blender, and those who want to change the animation and make a new AVI file. So the working starts here. Okay, initially we have a dialog box which asks for the password for the MySQL database which is on that particular user system. To make it clear, our complete GUI interacts with only the database. We do not interact with the XML thing. The XML output is given by the animator. So this increases the flexibility of a complete software. That way, see, if an animator had made some changes and he made an XML file, then we could have transferred that XML file along with the software. That way, the user can be anywhere. In fact, in simpler words, the software can be made distributed. Okay, fine. First of all we need to do is to import the XML file. The XML file contains the Blender, the name of the Blender file and all the attributes and all the objects which had been defined changeable in it. So we go on file and import. In import, we'll have to locate the XML file which has just been made by my friend. This is the one XML file which we had shown you. Okay, click on it and it's imported. So just a second. Yeah. Right. See, you can see the Blender file which has been imported right now. Now what we need to do, see, we have a search engine along to, what it does is, it searches for the blend file name, whatever blend file name you put in it. It has a filter mechanism inside it, and it selects the particular blend files which are relevant and shows them to you. Next, we need to select the blend file and click on OK. The next window pops up. These objects had been selected and made changeable in the previous presentation which we showed you. So we can select any one object right now, and it shows the frames, the particular frames in which we can actually change the animation. See, the animator decides on which frames the user can actually access the animation. It is not that user can like access any frame or anything, any object that he wants. Okay, first he selects the frame. See, these are the present location X, location Y, location Z, all those attributes which you had seen earlier. These are the present value, the minimum and the maximum value. So all these not changeable things which you are seeing, these are actually because the animator defined the minimum and maximum range of that object, of that attribute of that object as same. So you can't actually do anything about it. You can't change it. So we go on to what we can actually change. Okay, so we have a particular minimum and maximum value. So we try to, go below the minimum value, though it points it out and corrects the value. We try to go above the maximum value, like 4. It corrects the value and puts it 3. Next, what we need to do is we need to define the particular frames in which we want the animation to be rendered. The frames which have been, the complete set of frames like which are in the animation which we selected, the numbers animation, it has 1 to 275 frames in total. So obviously you need to select the start frame as greater than the first frame, and end frame should be less than the last frame, and the end frame should be greater than the start frame. Okay, wait. Before that, we also showed that we can actually put some logic in our animation, and we can make the logic thing changeable. So we go on edit and we go on logic. Okay, see, this logic has not been defined in this particular animation right now. So we'll show you in it in a separate file.
Restart it and put it on Blend 1.
Okay, see, go and edit logic. These logics have been defined in another blend file, a completely different blend file. Logic one, we go and same search engine works over here to same logic, and then we go on the logic we want to change and click on OK. These are the objects which have been chosen for the logic thing. Like if it is 4 plus 5, so 4 and 5 are the objects which we need to describe to the user so that he can actually change the operand in between them. The user is not allowed to make any changes in these objects. All you need, whenever you click on a particular object, you get the type as well as the value. So this describes the objects on which the logic is being acted upon. Thereafter, there's a list of the operands which the animator had decided that you can, you have the option of changing plus and minus. The current value which has been set in the blend file is plus. So we'll try changing it to minus. Whenever we will click OK button, all it does is that the value which has been chosen by the user, it's put in the database. So as I already told you before, our GUI acts only with the database thing. So we click on OK and the minus value goes on to be saved in the database. Click on OK. OK, fine, next, cross it up. Yeah, now we start, now we put the start frame and the end frame. Start that numbers for numbers. Okay, all this we had already done before. We start the start frame as 3 and end frame as 233, okay, and we go and save and exit. Now these values are actually put on, have been put on the database. So database's thing is converted into an XML by the database to XML converter, which is a Python script. And that XML thing is read by the Blender and it starts rendering. See, you can see the rendering thing happening. Telling you a fact that rendering of one frame takes 5 minutes. So we selected actually about 200 frames out here. So it will take, you can calculate the time it takes for rendering. So we can't actually render and show you right now, but we can show you an AVR file which we made by rendering a very, very small number of frames, maybe 5 frames. So it took us about 25 minutes to render, but we made an AVI file to show you what the actual final output is. Yeah, this is it. This is a very small AVI. This is because the number of frames is only 5 in it. First one. Yeah, this one. Exactly, it's only 5 frames. So we can't do much about it. Like if we had to completely render, then we would have to put it for one whole day or something.
Why does it take so long?
Sir, it's a Blender thing. It takes very long for each frame to get. All right, and I think this sums it up. Thanks a lot to Professor D.B. Fatuk for giving us such a wonderful opportunity. I think we did justice enough for this project. Thank you.
Good evening, all of you. I'm Prajyoti Wagmare, and I'd like to give you a short introduction about our project. As you can see, our project is the design and development of a scalable e-learning portal. Let me give you a short introduction. The really critical aspect of Indian educational system is that it still follows the chalk and talk method of delivering education. But in the 21st century, we have the capability to combine online learning and face-to-face meeting in what we call the blended learning. This has already been implemented in MIT's courseware under the Sakai project. Our main objective is to provide an environment in which different hierarchy of users, such as students, teachers, professionals, and educational administrators, can all work together in order to enrich quality of education, and it also aims to affect the construction of knowledge with reference to individual experience. Next. Thus, we came up with the idea of creating an e-learning portal. After a lot of research, we decided to use Joomla and Moodle for this purpose. Joomla is an open source content management system used to publish content over the World Wide Web. Now, why did we choose Joomla? Basically, the let me list the some of the features of Joomla. First of all, it is open source. That is, we can use it and edit it according to our requirements. Then we have decentralized editing on any browser. That is, the administrator can edit it and save the portal from anywhere in the world at any time. We have over 5,000 different plugins available with Joomla. Then there is a built-in feature for multiple languages. Joomla has been efficiently used worldwide over many professionals, thus its efficiency is tested and proved. It is highly easy to use. After installing it, even a non-professional can use it, can handle it actually. Next. Let us get acquainted with Moodle. Moodle is a learning management system using which we can create dynamic learning environment. Some of its features are that, first of all, it is open source. Then there are activities like assignments, tutorials, forums, polls, news. We have authentication system by username and password. There is enrollment system for students. Various graphical themes are already there in Moodle. We can give different roles to different users like teachers and students. We have integrated the features of Moodle and Joomla using JFusion in a single portal. Next. We have the features of visual integration. Moodle actually seems to be a part of Joomla using this. Then the single sign-on feature, which will ensure that if a person is logged into Joomla, he'll be automatically logged into Moodle, as well as vice versa. Then there is feature of user synchronization and centralized user profiles. The intended users who will be using our portal are teachers, students, educational administrators, professionals, alumni, and guests. There are some extra features given to teacher group, and they can handle a course, they can submit article, videos, create forums, chats, and blogs. Teachers, students are given some less privileges. They can just participate in forums, submit assignments and quizzes. And in the Joomla front end, student can submit articles, web links, and respond to forum and polls. Other users like professionals and alumni can submit articles and upload their videos from the Joomla front end. We have also integrated certain course modules, like available courses, in which there is it will be listed. All the courses in Moodle will be listed. Then there is My Course module, in which there will be a list of courses in which you have already enrolled. As you can see, there is the available course module and the My Courses module towards the left. Next. We have a Joomla Wiki as well as Moodle Wiki in our portal. Registered members can submit their article, and the article will be posted, reviewed and posted. We have version control feature also with Joomla, with Moodle. Some of the features in our portal are Flash. We have used this feature to display news. Then we have Moodle Chat. There is a message box in Joomla. If you post a message, it will be displayed on the site to everyone. Then there's the gallery feature. Let me call upon Rakesh to give a short demo of our site.
Thank you, Prajyoti, for giving us a short description of the project. Well, I'll give a short demonstration of our portal just after it's done configuring. Well, now I'd like to give a short demonstration of our portal. This is the front page of our portal. I don't know why it's coming so disorganized, but this is basically the front page of our portal, where we have the top menu and the side menu, and the over here we have the front page different articles. When the users post the articles, it will be automatically reflected on the front page. On the top menu, we have the about features. Knowledge portal refers to our Moodle site, which will open in a wrapper. About is basically about our project, and features are different features we have on our site. And on the top menu, we have the knowledge portal, which refers to the Moodle site, wiki, and gallery. In the main menu, I'll show you just a login, because here we have defined different user hierarchy, where different users will have different access rights and permissions, and they will have different features. As they will access the different features as per the permissions granted to them, we can create an account in this registration page. The fields which are marked as star are the fields necessary for the authentication of the users as well as the teachers, and there are different roles. These are the roles defined in our hierarchy, and the different colleges. And we have this CAPTCHA to prevent the automated mail, which will create spam and the registration on our website. After this, we can, my colleague can log in with my account. After we log in, we can see that my courses will be reflected on my front page. This is the content integration we have done with the Moodle. And on the top, we have the available courses. And the Moodle courses will have all the courses which are stored in my Joomla, in my Moodle site, which are the learning management system. We can see the user details, where my role will be reflected. And here I can modify, but this is not the final modification. If I change the role over here, this will be registered. This will be changed as a registered user. Then it will be up to the administrator, who is sitting at the back end, to authentify that this is a valid user and he's a teacher or a student. Then he will change the role as per the need of the situation. Then we can have different this chat box. This chat box is an Ajax-based chat box to stimulate the chatting of anybody who is online at that particular moment. Then in the top, we have In the top, we have forums. Forums are an essential part in this online educational system, because the student gets ample time to think of his responses, and this can give rise to a healthy response system between the student and the teacher. Here we can check out the different discussions which are going on, and the student can take part in any of the discussions, go to IIT Bombay and any of the thread. And my colleague will show you how to post anything, create a new thread or different things. We have this reply to topic or new thread, and these will be posted. And for the different things, please go back to the home page. We have articles. Articles can be posted by different users as per the permissions granted by them. The articles, after we have posted, this is posted by the users who have been given the editor rights. After an editor has published something, it needs to be published by the administrator. There are a set of administrators at the back end, and we have a super administrator who will ultimately be the guidance to all the people. And these things will be reflected on our articles, where we can submit an article. As a Rakesh, I logged in, so I had the privilege of a non-teaching staff, where I'll work under a teacher to administer his work. Then I have polling feature. This is how you can submit an article, and then you can go to polling feature. In the polling feature, we have different polls going on. Polls are an effective way to generate feedbacks and to collect them from the students as to how they are getting a comprehension of the materials given to them. With these feedbacks, we can generate a statistics based on the bar graph or the pie chart as per the need of the situation, where the bar graph and the pie charts need to be changed from the back end. That will be done by the administrator. And we have the different web links. Web links refers to the teacher links and student links. They will redirect you to the different pages of the different colleges or the educational sites which will be needed by the teachers or students. Then we have news feeds. And I'd like to show you after these the download and upload features we have on our website. Here's the download and upload section, where there are different videos on different sections like data structures and different lectures. Here the teacher or the students, even the students can, with those privileges, can upload those videos and different things which will be needed for the spreading of education in a better way. And after this, I'll put more stress on, sure, go to my courses. Here you can upload, this is the way you upload anything. You can upload anything, and after it is verified by the user administrator that it is not something unworthy of being put it on a portal, he will dismiss it or he'll publish it. Then we have comments and discussions where the users can take part in any comments or discussion going on, and we can participate with the different posts and articles. It's like a blogging feature on our portal. This is the way you submit an article. It will be directly be done by you. It need not be administered by the administrator, like we had in the our article section. Now we can go to, these are the courses in which I have enrolled. Please go to any of the courses. The Moodle courses reflect all the courses created in our Moodle section. Well, we all know that Moodle is a learning management system. It was mainly made to assess the grading system so that the chalk and talk method could be supplemented in a better way. It was never meant to replace the chalk and talk method, but just to add, augment it. Here you can enter into the courses. You can check the course teachers, and you can go back, see programming job. When you enter into the courses, you will see the features of Moodle wrapped up in a wrapper. As Moodle is not a Joomla content, we have to integrate it in a wrapper. Well, these are the different features or activities we have in our Moodle. Like we have the discussion forum, feedbacks, wiki. Wikis are specific to, over here the wikis are specific to your courses, and here you can put on your syllabus. This is the, there are different formats you put up in wiki. This is one of the formats we have imported, not specified in the Moodle section, but we made a module for it. And here you can have different lectures. Excuse me. Back. As you can see that different features, you can also have the chat boxes over here, private messaging, so that it can stimulate better interaction between the teacher and the student. Usually there are remote students who do not get enough time to interact with the teachers in the classrooms. And when you can shift your quizzes and forums and your assignment reviews over here, you can save ample time for your classrooms. By this, you can save ample time for in the classroom for the classroom discussions, problem solving, which normally in India, we our course time is very limited and we do not get enough time to give ample time to each and every student we have in our colleges. Well, after that, we can go to the wiki feature, wiki for our, this is the wiki for our every user. Here we have the version control mechanism where you can check out the different, go to index or there's a search. You will find what are the things we have pertained to see. And here you can check out what is the articles written on them. You can, as you have wiki, is a dynamic web content. It can be changed and modified as per the user, but the these things are not final. They will have a different versioning system so that if the changes made by the user it's unnecessary, it can be resolved back. And for different things, we have old revisions. It will be automatically generating the old revisions. I'm telling you that this was the time it was modified. And for now, these are the features. And we also have Jaliyat dikhayega. And for the minor project, we have one of our colleagues, Puneet, has made a XML parser for the question bank. We also have question banks for in Joomla, in Moodle, where you can import questions in different format, either in XML format or an icon format. Where in XML format, you have different question formats like subjective, objectives, and like true and false, different formats. He has made an XML parser just for the objective and subjective part using Qt 4.5, which is a library for C++. And these are the different features of our site. And I'd like to wrap it up now by giving my thanks to Fatak sir for such a project.
How long will it take for people to now start pushing deadlines?
So just 5 minutes.
And what is the scalability of the OT?
Like scalability as in?
What kind of hardware at the back end and bandwidth you will need?
So we haven't done those hardware testing because we never had those kinds of resources. It requires a type of black box and white box testing. But with the present requirements and the present things which are given to us, I think this will work fine for more than thousands of students and users.
Actually, our ambition is that the first portal that we launch mm-hmm. within about 2 years' time could be used by about 3 to 4 lakh students
okay.
and about 20,000 teachers.
Yeah.
So what we want to do is to begin with, as a part of the national project, we first want to expose it to only teachers mm-hmm. in so far as ability to post is concerned. And we will expose it to students in so far as any download or reading or anything is concerned. So in Joomla, mm-hmm. where I won't be running any courses through the portal to begin with. If I want to give access to a very large number of students hmm. in what you may crudely call a read-only thing,
okay.
no chat, no nothing,
okay.
how could I restrict that as a guest or they could still be registered, but their ability to do any inserts is restricted?
Here you can have the guest feature. You can make the materials which you need for a large number of people to be accessible by the guest features, like we have in the MIT Sakai project.
Yeah, the problem is we would also like to monitor who is downloading what, so that we know what are the preferences, what people find useful, etc.
And for that you have to go through a registration process.
Under the registration backend is a MySQL database, is it?
Yeah, MySQL okay. database. The backend is reflected in a GUI interface because in Joomla, which is a part of WCMS, it provides us with a front end, which is administered by the users and the different visitors, and at the back end, which is administered by the administrator himself. There are several administrators, there can be several administrators, and there can be several publishers and editors, and there must be just one super administrator mm. to head all this.
Okay. And what was the other question that I had in mind? Almost it slipped. Effectively, if I have inserted me, or let's take a professional from TCS who has inserted some very nice article on programming, or has actually uploaded a piece of Java code that he or she had written for something else.
Okay.
And I would like to make that accessible to, let's say, students who are registered on Moodle, which is part of the Joomla thing. Now, do I have to replicate that again by copying it in Moodle, or Moodle users can access the contents which are available independently in Joomla?
Presently, we don't have any such feature.
Okay.
We have provided the user hierarchy as the professional user,
okay.
in which the professional has the same rights as the teaching staff assistant,
okay.
where he can post articles on Joomla. But this article cannot be posted back without the help of the administrator on the Moodle side. It should be done by the administrator. We find it relevant, or if he thinks that in this particular course, this article will be needed for the students, then he'll post it on that course.
Fine. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good work.
Very good work. Very good. I am impressed. I was not very sure, because many of my colleagues felt that I am assembling too large a workforce, and usually, as you add people, it becomes counterproductive because the focus is lost. But I'm happy that you have done a lot of good work, and I'm encouraged to continue this next year, because the Dean R&D was asking me whether we'll continue that. He might formalize this scheme back again as a part of the Dean R&D's position. Anyway, I hope you have enjoyed your stay and you have learned something useful. So go back and do something still more useful. That's the idea. And maybe I would like to see some of you coming here for your master's courses. I got a mail from a student from VRC Nagpur. Anybody from Nagpur here? No. It's called VNIT, right? He was a part of the Clicker team last year, which had built the clickers. And the male says that he has just finished his BTEC and he has got admission to IISc Bangalore where he was to go. And he said, when I went to visit my department, I found 50 clicker devices there, because VNIT is a remote center where teachers are participating in our workshop. I don't know whether you are aware, the main workshop for the main project has just started, and we are in the third day, I think, or fourth day. And we will be using the clickers version 1 in a distributed fashion now. There are about 900 teachers who have assembled at 30 remote centers. So that is working. And now all the contributions that these teachers will make, or me and my colleagues will make, would have to eventually go into this website. So each and every project activity that you are doing, in one way or the other, will find or will make inroads into this collaborative effort. Hopefully there would be some teachers from your colleges attending the workshop, or some of them are organizing these workshops. Most of the NITs are our centers, right? Okay. So anyway, go back and please do two things. Give our greetings from IIT and my personal regards to your department head and your director, and tell them that Fatak was extremely happy with the kind of work that we have done. We'll most probably write letters to your institute directors saying that we enjoyed having you work here. And keep in touch. Do not forget to get a small snapshot of yours with a small description, because it should not happen that we release everything in open source and you are royally forgotten. Whatever little work, your work in the totality of the scheme might be a small percentage, but still important work, because that is what is furthering this cause. So thank you once again. Enjoy life. You have to